Now it's turned on. If the mic isn't turned on, nobody online hears me. Good morning and welcome to St. John's. We're very happy to have everybody here together today on the 28th of April, 2024. We are in the Easter season still. We're having our Sunday where we have a little more informal style of hymn. So we have with us our choir. Our soloist is not well this morning, so she is unfortunately unable to be here. We'll think of her. Our music director, Mrs. Grace Hahn. For those who don't know me, might watch later online, I'm the Reverend Maureen Walter, the minister of the church. For thousands of years, this land has been the traditional home of the Huron-Wendat, the Senecas, and most recently the Mississaugas of the Credit River. It is still home to Indigenous people from across Turtle Island, and we're grateful to work, live, and worship on this land. Our call to worship is printed on the bulletin. And Dr. Elizabeth Spears, our clerk of session, will help with our responses. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth.
Worship the Lord with gladness.
Come into God's presence with singing.
Christ is risen. Praise the Lord. Let us worship God.
Amen. We're beginning our service this morning a bit differently than usual. I think many of you have heard it's with grief that I tell you that our minister in association, the Reverend Dr. Charlotte Stewart, died this morning about 2 a.m. She had Ellen with her, one of her immediate family and others, and we will miss her in ways that we hardly understand yet. She has been everything to this congregation for so many decades. She's certainly been a close friend of mine for getting close to 50 years, about 48 or so. And we will all miss her very, very much. So before we sing our opening hymn, I would ask that you would join me in a memorial prayer for Charlotte. Lord God, our Savior, we give you thanks that Charlotte Stewart is with you in paradise this day, that she is dancing in your sunlight, enjoying the presence of that great cloud of witnesses which have been veiled to her but now are revealed, her friends, her family, her loved ones. We pray for those of us here for whom she has also been not just a friend, but a family member. We give you thanks that she was with us and blessed us with her years of ministry, her incredible gifts, for all the active work she did in this community and others in this country and many other places to improve the lives, the outlook, the hope, the health of so many people. Truly, we will never fully know the impact she has had on this world. But we do understand how much she has meant to us. And we pray that you would be with each one of us, comfort us as we grieve, help us to share our love, our insights, our wonderful stories of her with each other. And that one day we too would be part of that banqueting feast in heaven where we might be reunited in joy, in love, in mercy and laughter, full of your glory and light. Thank you for all our gifts, and thank you that Charlotte shared her life with us. In the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen. We'll sing hymn number 327, Sing Praise to God Who Reigns Above. We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 5. Let us pray. Lord God, the wonders of your creation, the splendor of the heavens, the beauty of the earth, the order and richness of nature, all speak to us of your glory. The coming of your Son, the presence of your Spirit, the fellowship of your church, show us the marvel of your love. And so we bring our worship and our adoration to you, O God of grace and glory, just as we recall in humbleness of heart those times when we have forgotten to worship you or failed to serve you, when we may have been careless of our world, or wandered from the ways which we were aiming for. We thank you for the help and concern of those around us, our teachers, our leaders, our friends who hold our hands when we need comfort. And we know that wherever we have experienced the love of others, We are able to do so because you love us and love them. And so, Lord, have mercy. God, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Forgive us whatever errors or sins we have made, and bring us to your everlasting life in this world and the next. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen. And be assured that in the love and mercy of God, we are a forgiven people. This day is a new day and a fresh start for each of us. We're going to read Psalm 22, verses 22 to 31. Jackie Harrison, Jackie Tonstra is going to assist us with the responses and read our first lesson to us after that. So we're at Psalm 22. At verse 22.
I will tell of your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you.
You who fear the Lord, praise God. All you offspring of Jacob, glorify God. Stand in awe, you offspring of Israel.
For you, Lord, did not despise or disdain the affliction or the afflicted.
You did not hide your face from me, but heard me when I cried to you.
From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will pay before those who fear you.
The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek the Lord shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. The great congregation there shall bring, and new generations God's praises will sing.
All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord,
and all the families of the nations shall worship before you.
For the dominion belongs to the Lord who rules over the nations.
All who sleep in the earth shall bow down to the Lord.
All who go down to the dust shall bow down before the Lord, and I shall live for God.
Posterity shall serve the Lord. Future generations will be told about the Lord and proclaim deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying that God has done it. Great congregation their worship shall bring, and new generations God's praises will sing.
Reading from Acts 8, verse 26 to 40, it is on page 1149 in your pew Bibles. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, go south to the road, the desert road, that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. So he started out, and on his way he met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of all the treasury of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians. This man had gone to Jerusalem to worship, and on his way home, was sitting in his chariot reading the book of Isaiah the prophet. The Spirit told Philip, go to that chariot and stay near it. Then Philip ran up to the chariot and heard the man reading Isaiah the prophet. Do you understand what you are reading? Philip asked. How can I, he said, unless someone explains it to me? So he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. The eunuch was reading this passage of scripture. He was like a sheep to the, he was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before the shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth. The eunuch asked Philip, tell me, please, who is the prophet talking about, himself or someone else? Then Philip began with that very passage of scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. As they traveled along the road, they came to some water. And the eunuch said, look, here is water. Why shouldn't I be baptized? And he gave orders to stop the chariot. Then both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord suddenly took Philip away, and the eunuch did not see him again, but went on his way rejoicing. Philip, however, appeared at Azotus and traveled about preaching the gospel in all the towns until he reached Caesarea. Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Julie Gangadine will read our other lessons to us.
The first lesson is from 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 to 21, and it's in your pew Bibles on page 1280. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent us his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we do love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in him and he in us. He has given us of his Spirit, and we have seen and testify that the Father has sent his Son to be Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. This is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. In this world, we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. Whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother and sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. And he has given us this commandment: anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. The second reading is John chapter 15, verses 1 to 8, and it's in your pew Bibles on page 1130. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. The word of the Lord.
Sing hymn number 252, He is Lord, and we'll sing that through twice, 252. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord. Amen. This morning, in the book of Acts, we read of Philip, one of the 12. This, of course, is following the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Philip is traveling in Samaria, preaching the gospel. While he is there, he hears an angel of the Lord telling him to go up to a wilderness road. The road runs between Jerusalem and Gaza, and it is seldom used. Philip follows the angel's directions and goes there. However, the road is not as deserted as he has expected it to be. A chariot approaches Philip, carrying an Ethiopian eunuch who is a highly ranked official in Ethiopia in charge of the treasury of the whole country. So in here, in modern day terms, we might think of such a person as the Minister of Finance or the head of the Bank of Canada or some other high ranking position. The Ethiopian in the chariot is reading aloud from the book of Isaiah. He's returning home from a trip to Jerusalem where he has gone to worship. Holy Spirit again directs Philip to approach the chariot, to join it. Philip approaches, and hearing what the official is reading, he asks the man, "Do you understand what you are reading?" The official says, "How can I, unless someone guides me?" We hear the tone of exasperation in the official's voice. He invites Philip to join him in the chariot. Philip talks to him, explaining how the prophet Isaiah foretold the good news of Jesus Christ and his resurrection. He shows how the sacrifice Jesus made for everyone is the fulfillment of God's promises. The official hears the good news and believes. They pass a small body of water, and the Ethiopian asks Philip, "What is to stop him from being baptized?" So they get out, get into the water, and Philip baptizes him. When they come up out of the water, the Spirit whisks Philip away. The official sees him no more, and he goes on his way rejoicing. Philip's journey continues elsewhere. We're never told any more about the Ethiopian eunuch. However, we know the Christian church in Ethiopia is one of the oldest Christian communities in the world. Ethiopian Coptic tradition remembers Mark the Apostle coming to Ethiopia to share the good news of the gospel and founding their church. Today's biblical account shows us Philip planted the first seeds of the Ethiopian church even earlier. Or perhaps it would be more accurate to say Holy Spirit working through Philip planted those first seeds. From our reading, we learn that Holy Spirit put Philip where he needed to be when he needed to be there. He followed the angel's voice, which we might understand as an inner impulse or a thought, to go to an area where few people went. And there, he found someone who wanted to know the very thing Philip understood and could teach him. A spiritual teacher once taught us in class that when we needed a teacher, we could be assured the teacher would appear. God would guide us where we needed to be, to learn what we needed to learn. This is another lesson we learn from today's readings. The Ethiopian was on his way home, where he would not have another chance to learn what he needed to know for a long time. Just as he is reading a passage he does not understand, his teacher appears. Why didn't Holy Spirit simply guide Philip to approach this official in Jerusalem? It seems Philip was sent to meet his student at the moment the student needed to learn and understand, and was frustrated at the lack of a teacher. God sends him the teacher he needs. We too can expect God will send us a teacher at the moment we are ready to hear. Once I was complaining to a friend about an ongoing annoyance. I'd known this friend for several years, and I knew that she'd sometimes been aggravated by similar things in her own life. And I have to say, it wasn't the first time I'd complained to her about it. After a few minutes of my griping away, she said, "You know, it's funny, Maureen. When that happens to me, I find it works best to just get it over with and then go on with my life." Who knows why she chose that moment to speak up? And I have to tell you, there wasn't any tone of censure or judgment in her voice. She simply shared what she did in a similar situation. But for some reason at that moment, her words not only resonated, but stayed with me, not just for that one thing, but for many things. Simply dealing with the problem when it came up was like cleaning up a glass of spilled milk. A few moments and it's done. Life goes on. Meanwhile, spending 2 hours complaining over the few moments of irritation ruined my day. It was one of those big life lessons delivered in one little sentence. It was not that I'd never heard such a thing before. It was more that I was ready to learn. When I was ready to learn, I was able to hear the teacher. The Ethiopian that day so long ago, he was ready to learn, and God sent the teacher who could teach him. We turn to John's gospel also today, in which Jesus teaches his disciples an image of discipleship. It is as if God is the vine grower and Jesus is the vine. The disciples are the branches on the vine. Jesus teaches about the life of the vine, which is to be fruitful. Branches that do not bear fruit are pruned away. Fruitful branches are tended and pruned, so they will produce more fruit. God is the gardener who understands what the plant needs to flourish. The vine is nurtured and pruned to become abundant. We rely on the guidance of God and the power of Holy Spirit to help us be where we need to be, to say what needs to be said, and to do what needs to be done. We rely on Holy Spirit to help us love our neighbors as they are and who they are, for they are as we are. We rely on God to help us meet our needs exactly where and as we are. Spirit leads us to include everyone because we live as branches of one vine. We are followers together, embedded in the same God. The image Jesus uses shows us the vine that is non-functioning, those branches that aren't functioning at all, are simply pruned away, and we don't have to worry about that. Each of us are connected to the vine, and we live in the vine. Some may worry that the fruitful branches are also pruned. We understand that to mean that we learn or are taught to discard those practices which do not help us. For example, I needed to lose the habit of complaining endlessly about minor issues. That behavior did not help me. It wasted big portions of my time, and it made me miserable. Pruning away that habit made me happier and more functional. It made me more fruitful. We all need pruning at various times of our lives. It's not a one-and-done thing. We need the aid of Holy Spirit throughout our lives. When we center ourselves in prayer and listen for God, we make ourselves open to God's working on us and through us. Then we're able to follow our impulses and hear the inner voice which is there to guide us. One more point we learn from today's lessons, and that is to be inclusive. People often say that the Bible says nothing about gay rights or gender inclusiveness. I think people say that only because we fail to notice the truth that is there, that anyone can say such a thing. The Ethiopian official was a eunuch, gender non-conforming, we might say in modern terms. He was a surgically altered, gender non-conforming person, such as many who live among us today. And how did God deal with this person who did not match societally expected patterns? God sent one of the 12 to him to teach him when he needed to be taught, to help him through his frustration and his exasperation, to proclaim the good news to me, to him, so that he might hear and believe, to give him that opportunity, and then to baptize him into the body of Christ. God accepted the Ethiopian exactly as he was, without asking him to change who he was as a person. Philip accepted him as a fully included member of the body of Christ, a true branch on a true vine. And we can do no less. It's part of our calling to share the love of God with all people, even when they don't conform to what we expect should be the norm. Each one of us reflects God's image as we are and as we live. When we share God's love, whether it's to invite a stranger to sit with us, to feed a hungry person, to start a health clinic, to comfort those who mourn, to call a friend when we think of them, or to pray for them when we can't meet them in person. We are bearing fruit. We seldom know the impact of what we do and say. Sometimes the full impact takes years to develop. We only know that we share God's truth whenever and wherever we can. God's love is what we share. The fruits which result of this sharing are beyond our knowing and imagining. God lives and reigns, and we are, all of us, and the world, blessed. Amen. We'll receive our offering. We thank you, Lord, for our gifts. We give back this portion to you and ask that we might be guided to use it in paths of faithfulness and service to you and the world, so that your love and light might be shared with everyone. In the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord, we pray. Amen. Thank you. Well, good morning again, and thank you very much, everyone, for being here. Coming up in the near future, on Thursdays, we continue to have our Wellness Energy Healing Group. That's from 10 until 12:30 every Thursday. And it's a wonderful group that does wonderful non-invasive type of energy work that often seems to help people feel a little better over time. It's a free group, and everybody is welcome to attend. I say it's ours, but actually it is put on by a group that really has worked and studied with this practice for many years and are wanting a place to be able to share it. So thank you very much for sharing it.
We opened another center yesterday.
Wonderful.
In Richmond Hill.
Oh, that's wonderful.
32 people attended.
Oh, that's great. So another center is being opened in Richmond Hill too. We are planning ahead for a spring sale on the 11th of May, and after church we're planning to have a little organizational meeting. Linda Miller is going to run that. You'll notice in the email and on the back of the bulletin there are a few more details somewhere, and it might be on the back of the, might be in the email, there is some information about what kind of donations we might hope to get. All the proceeds of the sale will come back to St. John's to help us run our programming, and we're very grateful for the help. And so many people who spent a lot of time and effort on this project in the past are very busy doing other things, so we're really hoping for volunteers. If you've never done a thing here before, we're delighted to have you join in. And if you've been a long-time active volunteer, we're grateful for everything you've done and hope you're able to keep going. So we will keep that in our calendar. There are no funeral details as yet for the Reverend Dr. Charlotte Stewart, but we will be, that will be, is being planned. And we will keep everyone informed when that will be held. So in the next week or two, watch your emails and we'll send out information about that as we know it. And again, our thoughts and prayers go to all of us who are deeply affected, but also to Charlotte's family, her friends, all those people who knew her, even the Presbytery of East Toronto. So many people in this community were affected by her life and work, her mission, and we hold everyone in our prayers on this loss. Also, you will see in our prayer list that's included in your email, we're remembering in prayer Candy Changer, who is also not feeling well at all these days. She's had long-term illness, and we are holding her in our prayers. And we also hold Maggie Joshi and her family in our prayers on the recent death of her brother. And all of those people who are deeply affected by that. That was out in BC. I think that all those are all of the announcements I have at the moment. Is there anything we need to sign? There's out in the back, we have a card to sign. That, I wonder, it's nice to have a little good news. Elizabeth Sepulveda Stewart is shortly to be married. And we're sending a card of congratulations to Elizabeth and our best wishes to her. So that's wonderful news. Her parents, Joanna Spurs, longtime members and adherents of the church here. And of course, we well remember her brother, who's I delight in hearing him on the radio all the time these days, and remember the days when he used to sing so frequently for us here with that incredible voice he had all his life. I'm delighted that there's good, happy news in that family. We will continue our service with prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, we join together to give you deep and hearty thanks for the many ways in which you have blessed us and guided us in this life. We thank you that you have given us so many gifts, so many close friends, that so many of us have become as if we are family, and that we truly have found a way to love one another. We thank you for the joy of home and family, for companionship, friends and neighbors, and for the fellowship of Holy Spirit that binds us together, that we truly are one, branches of one vine, all able to draw on your strength and power, so that we might be led in your ways, and that our paths might always bring us closer to you. We thank you for the strength that supports us, for the love that surrounds us, for times when our joy is complete, and for those times when we are touched by pain and filled with mourning. We give you thanks for your Holy Spirit at work in our church, in the church around the world that was and is to come, for the Holy Spirit that dwells within each one of us, revealing to us your truth, that each day we learn to live more closely in your love with you and with one another, and which brings us always towards your eternal kingdom. We pray for your church in this community, for all branches, and we pray for all people of all faiths who worship as they know you to be, who also we can learn to cooperate with, to share goodness, to feed the hungry, to care for the poor, to help one another, and know that all people are your people. We thank you for the courage and faith of your people who worship you through Christ Jesus, that your word may be preached and may live. And we pray for all levels of government and ask that they be given discernment and wisdom and a sense of the need for your justice, truth, and mercy. We especially remember in our prayers those people who have suffered harm, whether it is by accident, whether it is by design, whether it is individual aggression or an act of war or terrorism. We pray for those who suffer because of oppression and bias, racism and greed. We pray for everyone who is troubled, And we pray that those who are sick may be cared for. We thank you for all of those in our world who use their talents for help and for goodness. We ask that those who are lonely may be sustained, that those who are oppressed may be strengthened, that where there is war, we might not only pray for your peace, but do whatever it is we can to bring your peace into this world. And we ask that all those who mourn would be comforted, and that those who are close to death may know their Lord, and that those who have passed over to the other side may be celebrating their joyous reunion with you this day. For those who have died in the faith, especially those beloved by us, who have entered into your joy and peace of your nearer presence, we give thanks. Grant that we may follow their example and come to share with them the glory of everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with the Father and the Holy Spirit we worship and glorify forever. And now we pray together as we have been taught, saying, Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is a chorus, and it is printed on the back of your bulletin, Our God Reigns.
step you take, and may you know that you are loved, needed, and wanted in this world. Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, Son, and Holy